Hey, hi everybody. Welcome to Devotions Today. We've been looking at this in this last few weeks at what it means to stand from a biblical idea. We've been talking about what it means to stand on a strong foundation. We've been talking about what it means to stand in the gap, stand in for Jesus, because physically he's not here. He's left us with the job to do that. We've looked at what it means to stand together. We've looked at so many different aspects of what it means to stand. This last week, we've been looking at what it looks to stand strongly. A lot of pressure out there, I'm sure you've noticed. It would want to weight you down. And the test of your Christian experience is like it is with the squat, is are you able to stand under the weight? Now, we've looked at this from very few different angles, and I want to wind it in today. In Hebrews 11, we've been looking at that verse that says that a true believer is someone who believes that God is. And we've said, believe what about God that he is? And we've been saying that God is good despite a few things. We've got to believe that stuff. We've got to believe that God is good despite the fact that the evidence may suggest otherwise. We've got to believe that God is good even when it looks like he isn't. We've got to believe that God is good even when he doesn't fulfill what we think his promises to us should be, and a whole lot of others. But today I want to say to you that we've got to believe that God is good even when he doesn't answer our prayers the way that we want them answered. Sometimes we pray and we think God hasn't answered, but he has. He just hasn't answered in a way that we would want for him to answer. He may not have given us exactly what we asked for. He may not have given us exactly the thing that we have been begging for from him for maybe sometimes even years. It doesn't mean he hasn't answered. It may mean that he's saying wait. It may mean, for goodness sake, that he's saying no. Or it may mean that he has something else for us. And there is a purpose to him not answering our prayer in the way that we want him to answer it. You know, when Paul in 2 Corinthians asks God, he pleads with God three times. He says, God, I need your help. I've got this thorn in my flesh. We don't know what it was. Could have been his eyesight. Could have been depression. Could have been a way of thinking. We don't really know. But it was hindering Paul's progress in the gospel, or so he thought. But this was something that God had sent to him to fine-tune him, to keep him on track, and to keep him humble. And he says he pleaded with God three times that God would answer his prayer and take away the thorn that was in his flesh. But God did not answer his prayer the way that he wanted it answered. And eventually he said, Lord, what is it? Have I done something wrong? Is there sin in my life? Is there something? And God would probably have just smiled and said, no, Saul, the thorn stays. I have a reason for that thorn to be there. But here's the deal, Paul. My grace is sufficient for you, no matter how heavy the load. No matter how painful the thorn, the answer is not found in taking the thorn away. The answer is found in finding out how powerful my grace is. You see, grace is not just here to get us to heaven. Grace is to be able to make us to be everything that God wants us to be. It saves our souls. It forgives us as the wonder of this amazing grace. But it's so amazing that it's not just for here and for eternity, but it is for here as well. That God's grace is sufficient for you in every trial of life. God's grace is sufficient for you in every temptation that you have to face up against. God's grace is sufficient for your every physical and spiritual need. Now, Paul had to learn this lesson, and he learned it the hard way, but he never ever questions God's goodness. God is good, people. Even when he doesn't answer your prayer the way that you would want him to. The ultimate example of this has to be Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, doesn't it? When Jesus was in the garden and he said to his father, he said, Father, is there not another way that this cup can be taken from me? This is so painful. Do I have to go through this? My mind, my emotions, my everything, I'm sweating drops of blood here, Father. Is there not another way? And God said, no answer. He didn't say a thing. no answer. But Jesus suddenly realized, this is the plan of God for my life and for the good of mankind. His grace was sufficient for him at his time of greatest need. People, nothing's changed. Nothing's changed. You've been through some tough times this last year, I'm sure. You've been through some good times as well. Let's not get too miserable about this stuff. We've had some incredibly wonderful times. But here we are, standing with, and there's the thunder to affirm what I'm just saying. I hope you're listening, people. God's grace is sufficient for you, no matter the circumstance. I hope you get it. I hope you live it. I hope you respond to it. And I hope it puts a smile on your face. And let's live according to God's grace, not according to what we think we need. It's Friday. It's Christmas on Sunday. And I would just like to take these last few moments just to wish you all the most incredible Christmas season. Trust that you will know God's blessing. You will know His grace. Helena and I send lots of love to you all. And we look forward to sharing this special day with you. If you're watching from somewhere else, that's not just Port Shepstone guys and people, then I encourage you, find a great place to go and worship and to spend some time thinking about the wonder of the condescension of God, that He should become a man and dwell amongst us, die a cross, death upon a cross, so that we could have eternal life. People, that's incredible. I hope you find a place to go and thank Him for that wonderful gift that He has given to us in Jesus. But Helene and I send you lots of love. We'll be in touch soon. Bye-bye. Christmas.